Welcome all of you to this VTU e-learning course on kinematics of machine. The subject code being 18ME44, and we'll be discussing about gears and gear trains. Myself, Chandan V, assistant professor from mechanical department at Vidyavartaka College of Engineering, Mysore. Before studying this module on gears and gear train, so what would be the objective of studying this module? So the main objective would be to understand the theory behind gears as well as gear trains. Once you have learned the theory behind gears and gear trains, you would be able to use appropriate gears for a particular application with a proper mechanism design. The topics which are covered in this module would go like this. You have gear terminology, the law of gearing, the path of contact, arc of contact, the contact ratio of spur gear, interference in involute gears, method of avoiding interference, condition and expression for minimum number of teeth to avoid interference. And under gear trains, you have simple gear train, compound gear train, as well as epicyclic gear trains. And under epicyclic gear trains, you will be using two methods, one of which is algebraic and tabular method, and another one being tabular method for finding the velocity ratio of epicyclic gear trains. And also we'll be discussing regarding torque calculations in epicyclic gear trains. Coming to gears, or introduction to gears, why do we need gear? So whenever you're trying to transmit power between two shafts, so let's say you're using belt drive, rope drive, or some disc drives. As the power keeps on increasing, you want to transmit more amount of power from one shaft to another shaft. So as you keep on increasing the power and you're using either belt drive, rope drives, or disc drives, so at certain point, so they slip. So in order to avoid the slipping while transmitting very huge amount of power, we basically go for gear drives. And also in some cases, so because of the slipping, the velocity ratio between the two shafts or two gears or two friction wheels may not be constant. And in some precision machine, which is velocity ratio is very much important, so in such cases you cannot go for such a mode of power transmission, so you have to go with gear drives. And also one more advantage of using gear drives is whenever the distance between the two shafts are very small, so you can easily accommodate gear drives. So as you can see this diagram where the power is transmitted from one shaft to another shaft, we are using two wheels or discs. So the disc A is rotating in clockwise and the disc B is rotating in anti-clockwise. And you have the normal reaction Rn, as well as you have the tangential force B, as well as the resisting force, the frictional force, mu into normal reaction. So under such operation, okay, so in order to avoid slipping, so this force P, the tangential force P, or should always be greater than the frictional force. So if the frictional force is greater, becomes greater than this tangential force, slipping is bound to happen. So few more points on this friction wheel. So whatever the motion and the power transmitted by the gear will be kinematically equivalent to that which is transmitted by these discs. And when does the slip happen? It's been explained earlier. So the slip will happen whenever your frictional force would be greater than the tangential force, okay, which is acting. Now, if you provide teeth on the outer periphery of the disc, so it would look like this, and these are called gears. If you provide teeth on the outer periphery, so it would look like this, and these are called gears. As you can see here, so there are two things. One is a pitch circle, okay. So this pitch circle, okay, it usually represents, even though you are using a gears, so this pitch circle is it is equivalent to that of your disc, friction disc. It is equivalent to that of your friction disc. So coming to the advantages of gears, what is the advantage of gear drives? So if you use gear drives, you can provide exact velocity ratios, and also you can transmit large amount of power at higher efficiencies, and also it is reliable service, and you can have a compact layout in a small space. The power can be transmitted from one shaft to another shaft. Coming to disadvantages, so the manufacturing of these gears require special tools and equipments, and if there is an error while cutting the teeth, so this might cause a lot amount of vibration and noise during operation. So with these advantages and disadvantages of gear drives, so let's move on to what are the different classification of gears. So the gears can be classified based upon how the positions of the shafts are there, depending upon the relative position of the shaft and what would be the peripheral velocity of the gear, and also what type of gear it has got, and whether it has got an internal gear or an external gear, okay, and according to the position of the teeth on the gear surface. So this would be internal and external. So let's see one by one. So now this is classification according to the position of the shaft. So the two shafts in the same plane can be either parallel, or they can be intersecting, or they can be neither parallel nor intersecting. So for all these cases, whenever you are trying to transmit power between shafts which are parallel, which are intersecting, intersecting is in the sense they are at some angle, and in this they are at some angle and they are neither intersecting nor parallel, so those are called skew shafts. And now let's talk about some type of gears which are used to transmit power between two shafts which are parallel. So whenever you have two shafts which are parallel, and you can go with spur gears, you can go with rack and pinion, you can go with helical gear or double helical and herringbone gear. And one by one we'll discuss all of these in a short moment. Now coming to classification of gear, there was one more thing where whenever the two shafts are intersecting, so what type of gears needs to be used. And so in such cases we basically go with bevel gears. And when the shafts are neither intersecting nor parallel, in such cases we basically go with spiral gears. So those arrangement are called skew shafts. So this is a pictorial representation or a picture of your spur gears. So here such types of gears are used to transmit power between two shafts which are parallel. And here, as you can see, the teeth are parallel to the axis of the shaft. The teeth are parallel to the axis of the shaft. And helical gear is also an example for gears which is used to transmit power between two shafts which are parallel, and in this case the teeth are inclined to the axis of the gear. And these gears, compared to spur gear, can transmit more amount of power at a without making much amount of vibration or noise. And this is a picture of a double helical gear where you can see that the teeth are inclined again to the axis of the gear, and you have a left left hand teeth as well as a right hand teeth. And this double helical gear is used to overcome the disadvantage of a single helical gear. The single helical gear has got an axial thrust. In order to eliminate that axial thrust on the bearing, so we are using a right hand cut as well as a left hand cut helical gear, so that will be cancelled one. The axial forces will be nullified, and also the amount of power transmitted by such case are more compared to a single helical gear as well as a spur gear. And also such gears gives noiseless power transmission. Now we saw how to transmit power between two shafts which are parallel. Now we'll see how to transmit power between two shafts which are inclined. So in this case you can see that the two shafts are inclined at 90 degrees, and such gears are called bevel gears. Whenever you're trying to transmit power between two shafts which are intersecting. Now if you have this conical structure, and in this also the gear teeth, the teeth of the gear are inclined with respect to the axis of the shaft. Now if you have a spiral bevel gear, when the teeth of the gear here also the teeth of the gear are slightly curved, they are not straight with respect to the axis of the shaft, and this would be an example for power transmission when you are trying to transmit power between two shafts which are neither intersecting nor parallel, and you have crossed helical gear is one more example for transmitting power between two shafts which are neither intersecting nor parallel. Hypod gears is also one more example, and a worm gear. Now in case of worm gear, okay, so whenever you need a very large speed reduction, such gears can be used. Speed reductions from, let us say, 50:1 to 500:1 can be achieved using worm gears. So that was the classification of different types of gears, okay, depending upon the position of the shaft. So when the shafts are parallel, when the shafts are intersecting, and when the shafts are neither intersecting nor parallel. So whenever you have shafts which are parallel, you go with spur gear, helical or double helical. When the shafts are intersecting, you go with bevel, and when the shafts are neither intersecting nor bevel, sorry, neither intersecting nor parallel, you go with spiral gears. Now classification of what type of gears needs to be used depending upon the peripheral velocity. So you have three classifications. You have low velocity, medium velocity and high velocity. So you have gears, okay, which can be used at low velocity, which are 3 meters per second, so which are used for medium velocity between 3 to 15, and high velocity which is greater than 50. So one more classification of gears depending upon the type of gearing, whether you have an internal gearing, okay, so you have an external gearing or a rack and pinion. When I say that type of gearing, it means that how both the gears are in come in contact with each other. So whether they are the meshing happens externally or whether the meshing happens internally. Okay, depending upon that you have external gearing, internal gearing as well as rack and pinion. Now to talk about their meshing externally, so as you can see that you have two gears which are meshed externally, and in this case the two gears have meshed internally. Okay, so this teeth, the smaller gear is called the pinion, which has got teeth on the outer periphery, and the larger gear which has got internal teeth. So this is how your internal gearing works, and you have a rack and pinion. So this rack, you can consider rack to be a gear which has got infinite radius. So since it has got, as you will assume that it has got an infinite radius, so it is almost straight. So here also you have teeth on the outer surface. And this is one more gear, the smaller gear, which is usually called pinion. Even this has got a teeth on the outer periphery. Now there's one more classification according to the position of the teeth on the gear, which are the teeth could be straight, inclined or curved. So we have seen with respect to bevel and as well as burr. So you have straight teeth, inclined teeth. We have seen with respect to helical, okay, as well as helical gear. Yeah, even bevel, you have teeth which are inclined to the axis of the shaft, and you have curve. Okay, so we have seen this with respect to spiral gear, where the teeth are curved with respect to the axis of the shaft. So this is one more classification of your gears.
Now let's talk about the gear terminologies. So this is a pictorial representation of part of a gear. So there are different terminologies with respect to a gear, so we'll be discussing one by one. So in this slide you have three terms, which is the pitch circle, the pitch point and the pressure angle. Now with respect to this diagram, okay, so we'll discuss what is pitch circle. Now this pitch circle is a circle, okay, upon pure rolling action, which would give the same motion as that of the actual gear. So in other terms you can say that this is a circle which is drawn, okay, exactly at the center of the gear. Okay, exactly at the center of the gear, if you draw a circle, so which is passing at the intersection of the face and the flank. Okay, if you try to draw a circle, that would be the pitch circle. And another one what we discussed was the pitch point. We saw was pitch point. So pitch point is the point of contact of the two pitch circle. Now try to imagine there are two gears which are in mesh. So if you try to draw the pitch circle for both the gear, so they will intersect. So let us say you have one more gear here, okay, so the pitch circle of both the gear, let us say it intersects at this point, so that point is called the pitch point. And one more thing was the pressure angle. So to talk about the pressure angle, first let's discuss that. So whenever two gear tooths are in mesh, whenever you have two gear tooths which are in mesh, and at the point of contact of the gear tooth, if you try to draw a normal, if you try to draw a normal at the point of contact, and the angle made by this normal at the point of contact with one more line, okay, so that line being tangent to the pitch circle, so the angle made by a line which is normal to the point of contact as well as and the line which is tangent to the pitch circle, the angle made by between those two lines is the pressure angle. Usually the pressure angle will be 14.5 or 20 degrees. So that is discussed here. So as you can see the pressure angle, so this is the normal, okay, this is the normal, and this is the tangent at the pitch point. So this is the normal with respect to the point of contact. So wherever you have a point of contact, if you try to draw a normal, and this is the tangent to the pitch point, so the angle made between those two is the pressure angle. So other terminologies what you have is your addendum, dedendum, addendum circle and the dedendum circle, which is also called the root circle. So let's see that in the diagram. So the addendum, so your addendum is the radial distance which is measured from the pitch circle to the top of the tooth. So the radial distance which is measured from the pitch circle to the top of the tooth is the addendum. Similarly, the radial distance which is measured from the pitch circle to the bottom of the tooth, to the bottom of the tooth or the root circle, is will be your dedendum. And your addendum circle, the circle which is drawn through the top of the tooth, the circle which is drawn through the top of the tooth and which is concentric with the pitch circle, is your addendum circle and the dedendum circle. So your dedendum circle is again a circle which is drawn through the root of the tooth, which is drawn through the root of the tooth, okay, and which is parallel, concentric with the pitch circle is the dedendum circle. So that is explained here. What is addendum, dedendum, addendum circle and the dedendum circle, which is also called root circle. And the next is your circular pitch. Now, coming to circular pitch, so the circular pitch is nothing but the distance which is measured from one point on the tooth to the corresponding point on the next tooth, measured along the pitch circle, is your circular pitch. So here you can see, so from this point to this point, which is measured along the circumference of the pitch circle, is your circular pitch. Circular pitch is given by the formula pi times of pitch circle diameter. This is pitch circle, and the diameter corresponding to this pitch circle is your pitch circle diameter. Pi times of d divided by number of teeth on the gear will give you the circular pitch. And for two gears to mesh, okay, it's a necessary condition that both of them should have the same pitch circle. Sorry, circular pitch. Both of them should have the same circular pitch. So that is explained here. So circular pitch is given by pi d divided by t. So for two gears to mesh correctly, so the necessary condition is pi d1 by t1 is equal to pi d2 by t2. So the circular pitch should be same. So there's one more terminology which is called diametrical pitch. So diametrical pitch is the ratio of number of teeth to the pitch circle diameter in mm. And the module, it is the ratio of the pitch circle diameter in mm to the number of teeth. And with this diametrical pitch formula, you can substitute that in circular pitch. So your diametrical pitch and circular pitch are related by this pi. So diametrical pitch is equal to pi by circular pitch. And also your circular pitch can also be written as pi times of module if you use this equation. So circular pitch is also equal to pi times of module. Now clearance and tooth depth. Talking about clearance and tooth depth, so if you come back to this figure, your clearance and tooth depth, so your clearance is again it's a radial distance which is measured from the addendum to the dedendum of the meshing gear. It means to say that, so whenever you have one more tooth which is in mesh here, and if you try to measure the distance from the addendum of the meshing gear to the dedendum of the meshed gear here, so this distance is called the clearance. So one more terminology what we saw was the total depth. So coming back to the figure, so total depth, so the radial distance, the total radial distance, okay, from the addendum of tooth to the dedendum of the tooth is your total depth. So this would be the total depth. So if you add addendum and dedendum of a particular gear, so that will be the total depth of a tooth. So other terminologies what you have is a working depth, the tooth thickness and the tooth space. So coming back to this, the working depth. So when two gears have meshed, okay, when two gears have meshed, so you can say that your working depth is your radial distance from the addendum to the clearance circle. So the working depth is your radial distance from the addendum circle to the clearance circle. So also you can say that your working depth is the sum of the addendum of both the gears. If you add the addendum of both the gears, so that will give you the working depth. Next we saw what is, so the next terminology what we saw is tooth thickness and tooth space. So coming back to this figure, your tooth thickness and tooth space. So the distance, this distance is your tooth space. Your tooth space is the width of the tooth, the width of the tooth, okay, measured along the pit circle. So this is, you have your pit circle here. If you measure the width of the tooth along the pit circle, that will give you the width of the tooth. And the tooth space, and if you try to measure along the pit circle, the space in between the tooth, the space in between the tooth, so that will give you the tooth space. So now you have backlash and face of the tooth. Okay, you have a backlash and a face of the tooth. Now going back to the figure again, so when you have two teeth which are in contact, okay, or when two teeth which are in mesh, now your backlash, okay, is nothing but the difference between the difference in width between the tooth space and the tooth thickness. So that this is the tooth space and this is the tooth width, so the difference between these two would be the backlash. So theoretically the backlash should be zero, but in actual cases, if the backlash is zero, so the meshing teeth, okay, which comes and sits here, okay, it will try to jam. It will try to jam itself. So if for practical reasons, so the backlash will not be zero. Certain amount of gap will be provided here. The tooth space will be slightly larger. And the next, what we saw was the tooth face. So your tooth face, this is the surface which is above your pit surface. The surface of the tooth which is above the pit surface. So the pit surface is again an imaginary surface which is drawn along the pit circle. So your pit face is the surface of the tooth above the pit face. Similarly, you have the flank. So the tooth flank, this is the surface of the tooth which is below the pit surface. And you have the top plant. This is the surface of the tooth at the top of the gear tooth. The top of the gear tooth is called the top plant. And apart from that, you have the face width. This is the width, as you can see here, this is the width of the tooth, okay, which is along the axis of the gear. The width of the tooth along the axis of the gear is the face width. So we'll try to see a few more terminologies. So we saw what is the flank, what is the top plant, face width. Now you have a profile. So the curve which is formed from the face and the flank of the tooth, okay, will give you the profile of the curve, profile of the tooth. So that would be the profile. So you have a fillet radius. So your fillet radius is nothing but the radius which connects the flank of the tooth to the root circle. So you have the root circle or a dedandum circle. So the radius which connects the flank of the tooth to the dedandum circle is the fillet radius. There's one more thing called path of contact. So this, whenever you have two gears in mesh, okay, so the point, okay, the point of contact of both the gear teeth, the point of contact of both the gear teeth from the beginning of the engagement to the end of engagement, if you try to trace that, so that will give you the path of contact. So it is basically a path which is traced by a point from the beginning of engagement to end of engagement is the path of contact. Now you have one more terminology, which is length of path of contact. So this is the length of a common normal. So length of a common normal, which is cut off by the addendum circle of the wheel and the pinion. What it means to say is, so if you try to draw a normal at the point of contact, and let us assume that you have drawn a normal at the point of contact. Now this normal will be cut by the addendum circle of both the pinion as well as the one more gear. So the distance, if you try to measure between those two, is your length of path of contact. So in further slides I'll be showing you this path of contact. Similarly, you have arc of contact. Now arc of contact is nothing but the path traced by a point on the pit circle. So if you try to trace a point on the pit circle from the beginning of the engagement to the end of engagement, so that will give you the arc of contact. So the arc of approach and arc of recess. Now this arc of contact, as I told you, it is from beginning of engagement to end of engagement. You try to trace a point on the pit circle, so that will give you arc of contact. So this arc of contact has got can be divided into arc of approach plus arc of recess. So the arc of approach would be half of this, so it is from the beginning of engagement to the pitch point. So if you try to trace a point or trace a path from the trace the point of contact on the pitch circle from the beginning of engagement to the pitch point, so that is your arc of approach. And your arc of recess is if you try to trace the point of contact on the pitch circle from the pitch point to the end of engagement, that will give you the arc of recess. So one more term is the contact ratio. So the contact ratio will give you how many pairs of teeth are in contact, or the number of teeth which are in contact. So this is given by the length of arc of contact divided by circular pitch. So the contact ratio will give you the number of pairs of teeth in contact, which is given by the ratio of length of arc of contact divided by circular pitch. Now let's talk about gear materials. So the selection of materials for gear depends upon the service condition. So you can either use a metallic or non-metallic material for manufacturing of gears. The most common material which is used is cast iron, steel, bronze, and when we talk about non-metallic materials, we'll be using wood or compressed paper or even nylons. So if in a condition where there is a lot amount of wear and tear, so in such cases cast iron gears are preferred. Okay, so they have excellent wear resisting property and it is easy to manufacture cast iron gears. Talking about gears which are made up of steel, so whenever you need gears which are of high strength, so in such cases we usually go for gears which are made up of steel as well as alloy steel. So these can even be heat treated, so in order to take care of the proper toughness as well as the hardness requirement. Coming to bronze, okay, phosphor bronze gears. So these are usually used for worm gears, so where there's excessive amount of wear and tear as compared to cast iron and steel. So if you use cast iron or steel, so they wear out. So in such cases, phosphor bronze gears are used.